Good morning, everyone. My name is Dr. Olabiyi, and I work as a psychiatrist in the hospital. I also work as a psychiatrist on the eating disorder program. I'll be spending the next 45 to 50 minutes to talk to you about eating disorders, and I'll be focusing more on recognizing patients with eating disorder problems, how to assess them, arrive at a diagnosis, how to know when to admit them, indications for admissions, medical complications, psychiatric complications, principles of treatment, and outcome of treatment. Please feel free to ask me questions at any time. And if you don't understand me, please stop me and ask me to clarify. Okay? Now, we're going to start off by looking at this clinical scenario. And I want you to please feel free to shout what you think the possible diagnosis may be. So this is Mary. Mary is 15 years old, and she has a one-year history of binging several times a week. She does not vomit after binges. Mary spends at least 2 hours a day at the gym, and several times a week she attempts to get through the day without eating. She quit the swim team due to concerns about her body size. What are your thoughts?
Anorexia nervosa.
Okay. Anyone else?
A little obsessive.
Obsessive?
Yeah.
So like OCD?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Any other thoughts?
Body image issues.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. What else? Write this up a little bit. Okay, so a few things. She's binging, right? She's got body image issues. She's restricting as well, right? So the diagnosis can be a few things. It could be, you're right, it could be anorexia, the binging, subtype, right? Sorry, she does not vomit at all. Yeah, she's binging, so it could be anorexia. It could be bulimia nervosa, right? Because she's binging, and then she has body image issues as well, right? Or it could just be, what else? Atypical anorexia nervosa. The reason I brought this on is so that when I'm describing the various types of eating disorders, according to DSM-5, you will understand what the criteria are, okay? So in DSM-5, 8 diagnostic categories have been recognized. I'll be focusing more on the first 3 of them today. But before I go on, I want to say a few things about the last 3. So pica and rumination disorder and avoidance restrictive food intake disorders, they are new diagnostic categories in DSM-5. So pica is a situation whereby an individual eats non-food items repeatedly over a 1 month period. So it is quite common in people with intellectual disabilities. Okay, so if someone is eating non-food items repeatedly and it is not compatible to their developmental level, you want to think of pica. And as you can guess, it is associated with a lot of complications, you know. One of them being intestinal obstruction, iron deficiency anemia, a lot of dental erosion, stomach rupture, intestinal ruptures. We don't see it often in our program, but I work with the DDMH program in town, and we see them sometimes. Rumination disorder is also more common in individuals with intellectual disability. So what you see is that those individuals, they regurgitate food items, and the regurgitated food items can either be rechewed, re-swallowed, or they spit them out. And they do that repeatedly. So as I said, it's more common in people with intellectual disability. Avoidance restrictive food intake disorder is a little bit similar to anorexia nervosa. The difference is that with avoidance restrictive food intake disorder, you don't have body image issues. So what happens is that the individual just restricts and avoid food. And when you ask them why, they oftentimes describe anxiety, anxiety about vomiting, anxiety about choking when they eat, or they tell you they avoid food, certain food, because they are worried about the characteristics of the food, such as the smell of the food, the texture of the food, the look of the food. So those are the reasons they give. They don't have, they are not concerned about being overweight or being heavy. So that's the difference between avoidant restrictive food intake disorder, when you compare it to anorexia nervosa. The treatment is very similar. You know, what you need to do is normalize their eating, you know, so that you avoid malnutrition. Okay? All right, let's go to the two, the specified feeding and eating disorder, and then the unspecified feeding and eating disorder. Again, these are new diagnostic categories in DSM-5. In the previous editions of DSM, they used to be called EDNOS, eating disorders not otherwise specified. Okay? And we use the categories in situations whereby an individual does not fall into any particular box. You know? So you cannot classify them as being anorexic or bulimic or binge eating disorder. You use these two diagnoses. And examples will include things like night eating disorder, for instance. Things like atypical anorexia nervosa or purging disorder. Okay, so let me start off by, I'd like to spend a few minutes on the epidemiology of eating disorders. As we all know, it is many, many times more common in females than males. Now, both anorexia nervosa and bulimia nervosa are 10 times more common in females than males. Okay? The gender difference in relation to binge eating disorder is not that big, it's 2-1. And as you can see, we no longer have EDNOS in DSM-5. It used to be in DSM-4. Okay? So, thankfully, anorexia nervosa is not too common, you know. You have about 4 individuals in about 1,000 people. So, 0.04%. Bulimia is up to 1.5%. So, a lot more common than anorexia nervosa. And binge eating disorder is more common than the two of them. So, age of onset. For anorexia nervosa, is anything between the age of 13 and 20 years. Only about 5% of them will present after the age of 20. With bulimia nervosa, the age of onset is slightly later, so around 16 or 16 and a half years to about age 19. And with binge eating disorder, it could even be much later. So it's not unlikely to see people in colleges, in the universities, you know, young adults presenting with binge eating disorder. Okay, so three things to remember about anorexia nervosa. First of all, there is significant restriction in food intake leading to significant weight loss. Okay? The second criteria is that there's fear of weight gain or becoming fat. And the third criteria is that they have body image issues. You know, they could be like this, that when they look themselves in the mirror, they see themselves like this. Okay? So if you look at this criteria, we no longer talk about amenorrhea. And we no longer talk about having specific BMI or ideal body weight. Okay? In the previous editions of the DSM, they talk about BMIs, you know, the BMI has to be below 17.5. The ideal body weight has to be a certain number, then there must be amenorrhea. So amenorrhea as a criteria has been removed for two reasons. First of all, it allows us to capture those individuals, those young teenage girls who have not yet started their period. And the second reason is that it allows us to be able to make the diagnosis in boys. You get my point? So those are the two reasons. Now, you may want to ask, you know, what is a significant weight loss? So a significant weight loss would be, you know, what I do in the clinic is that I compare, you know, if let's say a 15-year-old is presenting with weight loss, you know, there's a graph, you know, and I compare what's the average weight, you know, for this individual, you know, and I, of course, you know, check the weight for the patient and then see how much weight the person has lost and within how much period of time. Okay? So, as I said earlier, this is similar to avoidant restrictive food intake disorder. The difference is that in avoidant restrictive food intake disorder, you don't have body image issues. And again, the weight of the patient is also significantly low. So very similar to this, but they don't have body image issues. That's the difference.
They often too are worried about being low weight.
Yes, they are worried.
They actually want to gain weight.
Yes, exactly. So you may want to ask again, how is this different from atypical anorexia nervosa? The only difference is that in atypical anorexia nervosa, their weight may be normal. They have lost weight. They have lost a significant amount of weight. But the current weight may be normal. And that's the only reason that they do not meet the criteria for anorexia nervosa. Does that make sense? Okay. So in the clinic, usually patients with anorexia nervosa do not come voluntarily for assessment. They are usually brought by their families because of significant weight loss within a short period of time. Okay? If they present by themselves, it's not because they are worried about the weight loss. Okay? They see weight loss as a sense of achievement. They feel proud about it. They are happy about it. They see weight gain as a significant failure. If they come by themselves to the emergency department or to the clinic, more often than not, it is because of the complications arising as a result of the weight loss. So things like dizziness, fatigue, fainting spells, not being able to stand up from a sitting position, or because they are becoming very depressed or very anxious. That's the reason they may come by themselves. Oftentimes, it's the family that bring them for assessment. So what I'm trying to say, in essence, is that patients with anorexia nervosa oftentimes don't have insight into their problems. They deny that they have any problems. Okay? Okay. So in bulimia nervosa, three things to remember. First of all, there's binge eating. The binge eating is accompanied by compensatory behaviors, and there's body image issues. So what's a binge? A binge is a situation whereby people eat very large amount of food within a very short period of time, and they feel a lack of control over the episode. They continue to eat even when they are feeling very full. So that's a binge. And it must occur together with compensatory behaviors at least once every week for 3 months for them to meet the diagnostic criteria for bulimia nervosa. What are compensatory behaviors? It's not only vomiting. It's not just by purging, you know. Compensatory behaviors include things like fasting, excessive exercise, use of laxatives, use of diuretics, enemas, and in certain situations, use of thyroid hormones. I've seen patients with diabetes mellitus who will manipulate their insulin dose so that when they binge, the food is not metabolized. Okay? That's also a compensatory behavior. All right. Let's talk about binge eating disorder. How is binge eating disorder different from bulimia?
They don't purge?
Yeah. They do not have compensatory behaviors. That's the difference. Okay? So the episode of binging must occur at least once a week for 3 months. They feel disgusted, depressed, after binging. They binge when they are alone. They continue to binge even when they are feeling uncomfortable. But they do not present with compensatory behaviors. And we don't tend to see them in the eating disorder program. My understanding is that they tend to present to weight loss clinics more often. And a lot of times, it is associated with complications as a result of obesity, so medical complications of hypertension and type 2 diabetes. Okay. Now, in the previous editions of DSM, these diagnostic categories would be EDNOS, eating disorders not otherwise specified. Okay. Now, as I said before, the only difference between atypical anorexia nervosa and anorexia nervosa is that in the atypical form, the weight could be normal. Okay. With purging disorder, the individual purges, but they don't binge. Okay. With night eating syndrome, the individuals, they eat large amount of food after awakening in the middle of sleep at night, or they consume very large amount of food after the evening meal. So not throughout the day, after the last meal of the day or in the middle of the night.
Can I just say something?
Yeah, sure.
That we've had youth brought to our clinic supposedly with worries about anorexia. And then it turned out because they would get up in the night and eat huge amounts of food. But when you look at the entire picture, this is a kid who is on stimulant medications for ADHD that suppress the appetite. And so when they don't eat much during the day, and then when the medication wears off in the evening, they're starving. So parents have been mistaken in thinking that this is abnormal behavior, part of an eating disorder, when in fact it's just their natural appetite waking them up saying, hey, we need food. That's something to look for when you see nighttime behavior, in my experience.
Yeah, that's true. It's actually common in people with insomnia. Okay, now, let's try and understand the psychological mechanisms in a patient presenting with an eating disorder. What's the reason? What's the etiology? Why do people present with eating disorders? Is it the same as dieting? Is it? Is it a lifestyle choice? No?
They may think it's lifestyle.
Sorry?
They may think it's lifestyle.
Yeah, but it's not. It's very, very different. Okay? An eating disorder is a very valid illness. It's a major illness that is associated with significant medical risks. It has to be taken very seriously. Okay? So, several factors are into play, you know, when you try to understand the etiology of an eating disorder. We need to consider things like genetic factors, the influence of the environment, and then psychological stressors. Right? We know that eating disorders are more prevalent in individuals with a family history of eating disorder, people with a family history of depression, anxiety, and obsessive compulsive disorder. All right? So the concordance rate in monozygotic twins is a lot higher than in dizygotic twins. So that's in support of the genetic contribution. But we know that it's not genetics alone. The influence of certain professions and certain hobbies, you know, things like acting, you know, fitness instructors, ballet dancers, they have higher prevalence of eating disorders than the general population. Okay? Then when you belong to a peer group whereby the focus of discussion every time is about weight, comparing how much weight you have lost, it's also a problem. Or when you've been subjected to certain stressors, and this is quite common, you know, this is what we see a lot in the clinic. You know, so people who have been teased about their weight at school, people who have been bullied about their weight, people who have experienced physical abuse, neglect, emotional abuse, sexual abuse, they become vulnerable, right? People experiencing abuse from their parents, parental divorce, all these are factors that if they are present in someone who is vulnerable, may tip them over to dieting. Okay? So a vulnerable youth is someone who is of a low self-esteem, someone who is a perfectionist, someone who has obsessive tendencies, someone with an impulsive tendencies. So if you have somebody like that with those stressors, they are more likely to develop an eating disorder. So in the presence of stressors, what people like to do is to feel better, to do something to feel better, right? They want something they can control. And oftentimes, food is what they can control. So they think, okay, maybe I will just lose a few pounds. So they start dieting. They take out certain food items, maybe fat, maybe meat, maybe dairies, you know. Usually that's how they start. Then they lose maybe 5 pounds and they feel better, they feel great. They receive positive comments from people. And what happens? They do more, you know. They lose extra few pounds and extra few pounds and extra few pounds until it goes out of control and they develop an eating disorder. Does that make sense? So the things to think about, the genetic factors, the vulnerability of the young person, and the presence of stressors. Okay? All right. Let's talk about the medical complications of eating disorders. One thing I'd like you to remember is that a lot of the complications that we see in patients presenting with eating disorder stem from malnutrition and purging. Malnutrition and purging. That's why the treatment is normalizing their eating. Okay? So, with anorexia, we see a lot of cardiac abnormalities, bone density changes leading to osteopenia and osteoporosis, fertility problems, amenorrhea, hypoglycemia, you know, low blood sugar, thyroid issues. With bulimics, what you see more is electrolyte imbalance from purging, you know, from use of laxatives. So their potassium is low, their sodium is low, calcium, magnesium, they are low. And we know the influence of potassium on the cardiac, on the heart function, you know. So they also present with cardiac arrhythmias, they present with bradycardia, and if they are vomiting a lot, profusely, you see dental erosion, you see tears to the esophagus, and in very severe cases, stomach rupture. This is why, if you are thinking that somebody may have an eating disorder, you need to take it very seriously.